an important idea. And you have vertical line and you have a horizontal line and obviously the center point with circular movement. And this is really important. The vertical line is the spine. So this is the line that we need to kind of pay attention to. All strong movement in Aikido tends to come from this, at least at the beginning. This is lined up. Then it may split off. Always straight down your midline. Even Yokomen come back to the center line and so on. So these are all really important things to think about. The horizontal line is the hip movement. So as we do this movement, we do this movement with the hips. Right? Even if it's very small and subtle, it's some hip turn. So you have both this movement and this movement always in Aikido, and therefore you have spirals going up or coming down. So we'll play with a little bit of that.
Awesome.
So as he holds, he wants to project through my arm to control my center. So this is good. You notice even his body changed angles a little bit. So sometimes when we grab, we're straight onto each other. This is really difficult now to move. But if he's trying to project, this is yes. He moves ever so slightly to the side because now it's difficult for me to hit him from this hand or kick from this side. Not necessarily impossible, but very difficult. But this now creates an opening over here. So I'll open my hip, drop the elbow, extend.
Hey.
So you don't have to start from this position, but this is the elbow. So he's projecting ever so slightly from an angle, but not dead on. So here, extend, hyperextend the wrists, drop your shoulder, drop your elbow, open your head.
Turn.
I could. It confused me a lot. So I'll show you the first style that I learned. I believe that Lasse Sensei learned this as well. So, but the confusing part is, depending on what Saito Sensei wanted to show, he sometimes did it differently. You know, this is not exactly the same. His words were the same, you know, but his movement wasn't the same as his words. It's like the picture didn't match the words underneath. So it's an interesting thing. But we'll play with both, okay? So my partner grabs. So this first method is we'll press our hands like we're doing a push-up on the floor. So this is my word for hyperextension, but it's like a push-up on the floor. The point, the center point is gonna be right here for the movement of my arm. So right at this part of the wrist, I'm gonna rotate my wrist this way, and I'm gonna drop my elbow this way. You notice his body already shifted, and I didn't even move my hips yet. So this motion will change everything in my partner's body. Then I'm gonna pivot around this point with the elbow joint and move my body. Now raise up. So this movement, so the idea is to hold this, drop the elbow, drop the shoulder, right? Pivot around this point, enter in, turn the hips completely, raise up. Okay? So, if I were to, this is the heaviest barbell I've ever lifted. Sorry. If I lift, I want to get my body underneath the weight to lift up, right? I mean, just, this is going to be really hard, or I'd never be able to do something like this with weight. So, if this is a heavy weight, I want to either bring the weight under, over my body, over my legs, and then use the legs to push up with the arms, right? It wouldn't be just, you can, but I think this would be very hard. There's a tendency to want to load the legs, put the weight here, and then push up and use that momentum that you've created to lift the rest of the weight up. So when you do this kind of motion, so as you step here, the motion is here. Use your legs. So you're gonna push off a little bit.
Eight.
Step. You're using your legs to get your partner to balance. If you use your arms only, this is really hard. Only his arms move. If you use your legs, his whole body moves. Okay? Sometimes when we, for instance, use this diagram of the circle and then the cross in between, we think of it in just a vertical space, like this. So I think, oh, here's this. But you can also turn it down so that it's a diagram on the floor. And you look, these kind of movements. Where's the center? Maybe this junction. Here's one line. Here's another line. So when you do, for instance, morote dori, you want to step and get off the line. You don't want to be on the same line as your partner because that's where their strength is. You can't go through their strength. Or you can, but it's too much work. So turn. Let their power go past you, and then throw. Their power is from their center. It's not the arms, even though the arms are grabbing your arms, right? So this is a very difficult thing. So my partner holds on. Set us on this line. Yes, good. So this is the line. If I stay on this line, she's very strong here. This is really hard work. If I can open, then their center goes past. So set your center.
Turn.
This feels pretty good, but in fact, her arm is in a very strong position. So I need to match her center. Now her body begins to move. Then throw. Okay?
I cut it.
Moving deeply, displacing your partner's center, and then throw. So this is a very good basic method. The next method I'd like to show you is relying more on kokyu. So this type of kokyu that we'll be doing, we're working outside of the power of our partner. So O-sensei would say, back to the circle, your power or your partner's power is within a certain circle. Outside that circle, they become weak. So we're going to try and work on the very outside edges of that circle. So the outside of the circle doesn't mean 1 foot, doesn't mean 6 inches. It can mean just the width of the line that we think is the circle of a person's strength. You know? So this is like, okay, what the heck is he talking about? So I'm going to ask you to make a fist. So if I push here, she's really strong. If I tell her, don't move your wrist, don't let me move your hand. I'm going to push it this way, so don't let me move it. Good. She's strong. I'm going to push this way. So, you know, Saito-sensei used to go, okay, look, you can just go like this, not even touch them, and then don't let me move your wrist. You can move your wrist. But what am I doing? Say, without saying anything, you never know. But what I'm doing is, if her wrist is like this sleeve, I'm just pulling her sleeve out a little bit. Now I can move easily. If I leave it so it's wrinkled, it's really hard to move if I try and move this way or this way. But, okay, so this is not magic. You can do this as well. But this is the principle of what we're going to do now. So here, her strength is right here. So I'm not going to enter quite as deeply. I'm going to step in front of her. Keep this in front of the center. Strong kokyu. And then. So this is very different. So if I enter deeply, this is different technique, right? This is slightly different. So I'm not going to enter as deeply. I'll enter shallow. Keep this in front of the center. Kokyu. Okay? I want to be very specific rather than be vague. One more time. So she grabs. I'm not going to hit you with the jaw, by the way. So here's the line that I need to think about. So this line is the line around which I move. So I won't want to step too deeply here because now I've passed the line. So in this instance, I'm going to keep the line here. And once I get here, I'm going to create kokyu and then go. So right in between her wrists is the line that I want to pay attention to. I'll step and then come up. Okay?
I understand.
State your question and then maybe we can work it out all together.
So the first motion, if I go to out, if I go to her, my partner with that tree, I can hook you here. I feel that I might lose the contact, and that's the whole idea is waste, because I want to keep the contact. Yeah. So then I go out.
One more time. So please watch. So right here she begins to lose her center line and her arm. So the center line and the arm need to face each other. So your center line and your wrist as you enter. Yes. There you go. Now stand up. So this, you need this in alignment, but not this kind of alignment. If you turn and break the alignment, it's going to be difficult. The other thing that I saw that is, many of us have a problem with is we over bend the arm. You feel, I can't move in, so your arm gets too bent. You know, so this is a difficult thing. So if my partner holds firmly, it's like try and move in here. But you want to hold this position. This is the point to think about, not here. And once you move through, you can move easily. So this is the point to think of moving around and then project through. So hyperextend the wrist, step in but not too deeply, align, draw them out, and then go. Okay? Definitely that idea of the circle and the vertical line, horizontal line, but also the, if you will, the notion of the arm as a hand sword. So this is the old name for the arm, right? It's the hand sword. So in Japanese, tegatana. But the tegatana, the hand sword, is not just in the hand. Sometimes you want to think of the hand sword with the hilt here at the base of the palm and at the little fingertip. So this is the tip of the sword, this is the hilt of the sword, the base of the sword. So if you look at both hands, this, my little hand in comparison to the big sword, but it's parallel. The base of the hand, the palm, the little fingertip. But also, this parallel can be made with the little fingertip being the tip of the sword and the base of the elbow being the hilt of the sword. So sometimes it changes. So depending on how you do a technique, you'll feel this is the hand sword, and other times you'll feel this is the hand sword. So in this instance, when we turn, we want to make sure the blade is pointing how we normally lift the blade, not sideways. So this is a really important idea that the blade is pointing exactly. So the elbow and the outer part of the bones are lined up as the sword point, and then turn. This is sort of the old ways.